another announcement. We're going to start having a lot of ads this week, just trying to get this on everyone's radar who wants to come to it, but May 5th, 9 a.m. to 1 p.m., we are having what we're calling a Growing Young Workshop. Again, this is not a workshop for young people. That is not the goal at all in any way, shape, or form. But instead, the goal of it is for anyone in our church that would like to come to it to kind of see what the recent stats and research and all that kind of stuff is in regards to what makes particularly what we call the millennial generation or the Gen Z very unique compared to previous generations. And as a church, what we can maybe think about as we're thinking about long-term strategies and what we ought to do as a congregation. So that's going to be May 5th, 9 a.m. to 1 p.m. All of our church, all of our council, most of the board members, all of the Women St. Paul leaders, they are all going to be there. But we would like as many other people to be a part of this as well. So that's May 5th. All right, John, tell me about John. One last chance for a recap. One last chance.
You're the only one that Jesus said. Crucifixion.
Yeah, the only disciple that we know of at Jesus' crucifixion. We want to add a couple caveats there. So this, again, is that wonderful Tizoc painting of Jesus looking down from the cross. And where's John? Yeah, he's right there. How do you know that's John?
No beard.
No beard, right? So classic art. He usually does not have a beard. Or he's got just one of those little soul patches. Is that what they're called? And that's how we know who John is. Then we've got the women there as well. So good. John was at the cross. What else do we know about?
He was around for most all the big events that are recorded with Jesus.
Yeah, if we think about this, if we just kind of let the Gospel of John speak for itself and its kind of literary qualities and things like that come forward, it seems very probable, very likely that John was a disciple of John the Baptist. And that when John the Baptist said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world," John was one of those very first disciples, one of the first one or two, that then went from John the Baptist to Jesus and stayed with him for the entire ministry. Virtually everything that Jesus did in public with people, John was almost at every single one of those things, definitely at all of them that had to do with the disciples. Every now and then, Jesus goes into a quiet room by himself and something happens, but otherwise, John's going to be there. So amazing, if we think about this, the fact that we have this disciple who was with Jesus every step of the way. We have a gospel written by him, we have three letters written by him, and then we've got that apocalyptic book, Revelation, at the end, all written by John. That's fantastic, if we think about it. Good. Other thoughts? Other things we know about John?
Well, isn't they always say he's the one that Jesus loves.
Yeah. There's that very special kind of way that he describes himself in John's gospel. Was John saying that Jesus loved him more than everyone else?
No.
What was his point in describing himself in that way?
His close friend.
Yeah, close friend. John's gospel is especially designed to show us the heart of Jesus, to see how Jesus loved and cared for people. This was not just some guy that came in, some savior that clocked in, did his savior thing, and clocked out in some unpassionate way. He loved us. He loved his disciples. He was deeply friends with them, and we get to see that on every page, every sentence of the Gospel of John as it comes forward. And the way that, just one of those ways that we see that is how John describes himself, demonstrating this close love that Jesus had for him. Good. Other things about John? What about after Jesus' life and ministry? After Jesus' ministry, death, resurrection?
First, second, and third John.
Yeah, first, second, and third John. Yep, Revelation. What do we know about him after?
He went to the
Bishop. Bishop of? Ephesus, right? So your handouts have a map somewhere on them in the back, I think. Christianity starts down here. And then it disperses this direction. And we have major centers in Alexandria, major centers in Corinth, major center in Rome. We also have a major center in Ephesus. and this is where John will become a bishop. How long does he serve as bishop there? Until when? There's a timeline too.
90.
Very front.
98.
Yeah, so his entire life. He serves as bishop there until he dies. How old was Jesus when he was disciple of Jesus, or how old was John when he was disciple of Jesus? Yeah, we're thinking early 20s. Early 20s, he becomes a disciple of Jesus. If that's the case, then how many years did he spend in the ministry? Yes, 70-some years. 70-some years! God preserved him to spread the gospel message throughout the world and to be a church leader and to work with those growing churches. 70 years! So, an amazing, amazing figure that we have in John who wrote this letter for us. Good. Once again, he wrote 1st, 2nd, 3rd John, which are letters. Are they exactly letters? How are they not the same as Paul's letters?
They're poetic.
Yeah, they're kind of more like written sermons, especially 1st John, right? So 1st John is a written sermon, a written speech, a motivational something or other that he's sending out there, whereas Paul's letters begin with, I, Paul, am writing to such and such, and then he ends it with, give my greetings to such and such, and things like that. We don't have that with John. He's got a very different style that he's going about doing it. But it's not a book. It's not something like apocryphal literature. It's something all in its own. It's like a movable sermon that's being circulated. The Gospel of John, Revelation. And if we're thinking about the style of John's writing, this was just our real simple way of talking about it. John's works all have a reputation for using the simplest language, but conveying the most philosophical and poetic ideas of the New Testament. So John, we called him the Hemingway of the New Testament. Very simple language. Very simple language. One syllable, two syllable words. A very low reading level, so to speak. Very short sentences. A very small vocabulary. But yet, the concepts that he is talking about, the things that he are describing, they run as deep as they come in Scripture and on this planet. There's no question about it. So just think of the first couple sentences of John's gospel, which are?
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. Huh? So all of them were basically one-syllable words, and he's capturing beautifully the essence of the Trinity and the nature of Jesus in these deep, eternal ways, and trying to explain. If you're thinking about it, Christianity, as we know, it's only been around for 50 years, and he's writing the first treatise on the Trinity, trying to explain this nature of God, and he does it in the most beautiful, elegant ways possible. And we've noticed that over the last 8-9 weeks that we've been going through 1 John here, that it is just gorgeous, beautiful language that he uses to describe very deep concepts. What's the difference, though, between John's Gospel and 1 John as we've been going through it, as far as their topics and their subject matter? If you were to kind of put this in your brain, what's the big difference? There's lots of similar themes. What's John's Gospel about? Jesus. Good, right? It's about the life and nature of Jesus. What's 1 John about? Love. Now, the gospel is a lot about love, too.
God is light, God is love.
What's that?
God is light, God is love.
Yeah, God is light, God is love. Now, those concepts are all over the gospel as well. So how is the letter different than the gospel in regards to those concepts?
How it applies to us in our lives and how as we treat other people, both believers and non-believers.
Yeah. So the gospel is that testimony, that eyewitness testimony of the light coming into the world. It's God's John's eyewitness testimony of God enacting his love through Jesus for this planet. And 1 John then are the logical implications of that for us as Christians, how that light affects our lives, what it calls us into, and how Christ's love then becomes reflected through us into our lives and into our communities and creating Christian communities. So they go wonderfully together. If you want to give yourself a treat for your devotional life or for whatever it is, read the Gospel of John and then read 1 John right after it. or intersperse them together, but in some way go through them on your own so that you can see the relationship between them and how one just naturally complements the other. They are a beautiful, beautiful thing that works together. Yeah, so if we're to summarize this, the poetic themes of John: God is light, God is love, John's applications, and we're just talking about the first John here. So the poetic themes of first John: the first half, roughly, God is light. The second half, roughly, God is love. The applications, then, is you let your light shine in this world. You will be different. God calls you into a lifestyle that will look different than other people in the community or in the culture, in the neighborhood that you find yourself in. And then second, God's love will lead to community. And we talked about this major theme that runs through John of joy being made complete. In fact, that's some of the very first words of the letter, that John is writing this to make our joy complete. And that joy becomes complete through fellowship. And so, major things that are kind of running through it. And so let's dive right into the final section of 1 John. Maybe right real quickly before we begin, I'm running out of handouts. This is the last time we're doing it. We've got a few. If someone's got extras on their tables, just start passing them back that way. I'm going to leave a couple there for the Wingless Boys if they show up. But if you turn to page 16, Appendix A there, those are the major themes, okay? So keep those in mind either today or while you're reading 1 John on your own. If you ever get confused about what John is saying, if you ever think that doesn't sound Christian, it's because you need to read it in the full context, the full themes of what he's trying to express. And we got them as a summary there. God became incarnate in Jesus to die for our sins, give us the gift of eternal life through hearing the gospel, that is the testimony of the apostles. He talks about his testimony. God gives us his spirit. The spirit in us, on the one hand, believes in Jesus, and in the second, seeks to pattern one's life after God's will. Refusing to acknowledge Jesus as God's incarnate son is of the devil. So we've got lots of language about the Antichrist in this letter. And then refusing to change the sinful patterns in one's life is to refuse the gospel, and it's also of the devil. John seeks to motivate us to change sinful patterns in our lives. But when we sin in the midst of seeking to pattern one's life after God's will, the forgiveness of Jesus is right there. So again, his main goal is he says, if you are a Christian, then you will change the sinful patterns in your life, the sinful habits in your life. This is a necessary effect of the Holy Spirit living within you. He is not saying, and he makes a big point of this, that you will become perfect, that you can get rid of sin in your life. He says you need to continue to confess your sins, rely on Jesus for salvation. But nevertheless, we're not asking for too tall of an order, that life will somehow change when you become a Christian, and that you will address the things that you know are sinful habits, things that you know were sinful parts of your life before you were a Christian. You will work hard to make your life different. Make sense? All right. Now with that, the video.
It's pretty interesting with all the things that are in the news here lately about abortion and Planned Parenthood, the feelings that it's dredged up inside of me. It was pretty unexpected. You know, I had an unwanted pregnancy at 17 with very little support. I came to Austin and had the abortion. I don't believe in doing protesting or ridiculing women who are walking into an abortion clinic, because we never know why they're walking into that clinic. When I found out that I was pregnant, I didn't feel like anybody in this world understood what I was facing. I was alone. I was scared with very little support. I wish I had someone that would have loved me and loved my baby, and somebody that would have encouraged me and said, you can do this. This is what you are made to do. You're going to be okay. This is a diaper wreath. We're going to put this over here. So this will be our sixth bundle of Hope Shower. We love on moms who don't have a lot of family support or don't have the financial support they need. The ladies in our church bring food and everybody brings gifts to let women know that there are people out there that care about them and want to help them. I think it's very easy for us to say, you know, oh man, a baby's a blessing, and you know, why would you do anything different? But you know, it's not to everybody. It's scary. When I see a girl that's in this situation, my heart automatically breaks. Usually one of the very first things I say to our moms is, you know, it's okay to be scared around me. It's okay to cry. It's okay to be angry, you know? Those are all very natural emotions in the situation that you're in. Can you take that to Miss Candace? When we can just love them, just because that's what Jesus does to our heart. He calls us to love. I mean, sometimes they're feeling love for the very first time in their life.
Ladies, again, I just want to say thank you so much for coming today to Love on Candace. And Candace is special to me, and so...
I struggled with whether or not to play this video. I really, really wanted to, but it hit home on a number of levels with our church family. So, are there people that you know that are part of our church family that have had unplanned pregnancies? You bet. Are there members of our church family here that have had abortions? You bet. Are there people that are carrying around tremendous amounts of guilt because of this? Are there people in our family that are carrying tremendous amounts of feelings of loneliness? You bet. What does 1 John have to do with this? 1 John's about community.
Forgiveness.
It's about forgiveness.
Love.
What's that?
Love.
Yeah.
Unconditional love.
Unconditional love. It's a huge part of it. And what happens to that unconditional love? So we spent a couple weeks talking about the different types of love in the Greek language, right? We talked about storge, and we talked about phileo, and we talked about agape love. And all the different types. And what's agape love? What's agape love? God's love, it is.
Agape love is not because of, it's in spite of.
Yeah.
And unlike the eros love, which is because of, and also phileo is because of,
yep.
But agape is in spite of.
Yes, thank you. Right? So storge love is because you are my family, I'm going to love you. Eros love, romantic love is because you're attractive, I'm going to be romantically attracted to you. Phileo love is because we've got a lot of things in common, I'm going to love you as a friend. Agape love is because, well, wait a minute, there is no because. There's nothing in that subject that is drawing me to love that person. Instead, I'm simply going to love them. Now, here's the key, though. 1 John does not simply describe Jesus' agape love in abstract terms, that God loves you. Instead, 1 John, John in his letter goes on to say what? How did God show that he loved you? He put that love into action. He became a human and died on the cross for you. And John's point is not that Christians need to somehow comprehend the abstract notion of agape love. His point is that Christians put that love into practice. That love reshapes our relationships and our communities. And so a lot of the videos that we've been playing from, what's the organization called again?
DDoS?
Yeah. What's that?
You talking about DDoS?
DDoS, right? This series that we've been playing, that's the whole point, right? Is these are illustrations of agape love put into action. And we need to find ways of doing that as a church body. We are, there's no question. But John pushes us. He pushes us to the limit to find as many ways as possible to create genuine relationships through acts of real selfless love for each other. That's the theme at the end of the day. So as we go on, so in 1 John 5, there's a couple kind of interesting sections here. Could someone please read for us this passage? I might get a little caffeine.
This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He did not come by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth. For there are three that testify, the Spirit, the water, and the blood. And the three are in agreement. We accept man's testimony, but God's testimony is greater because it is the testimony of God which he has given about his Son. Anyone who believes in the Son of God has his testimony in his heart. Anyone who does not believe God has made him out to be a liar because he has not believed the testimony God has given about his Son. And this is the testimony. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life.
Yeah, so again, notice how many simple two-syllable words John uses here, but yet, right, he's got a lot going on, a ridiculous amount going on here. What's the main thrust? Before we get into the details, what's the main thrust, his point, overall point? Yeah, right. If you want to say that you have listened to God's testimony, that you are following what God wants you to follow, then you have to trust in the testimony that God gave you, which was God's given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. So the point is God said that he sent Jesus. So if you want to be on God's side, if you want to be a listener of God, then you will listen to what he says. You'll become a follower of Jesus, right? That's, in general, the point he's talking about. That God has given testimony that Jesus is his Son. Now, the question is, where was that testimony that God gave? And John uses some very strange language here. He says there's three that testify. The Spirit, the water, and the blood, and the three are in agreement, he says. What in the world's John talking about? How are these three things testifying? The Spirit, the water, and the blood. How are those things testifying that Jesus is God's Son?
God the Father testified at Jesus' baptism.
Yeah.
This is my beloved Son.
Good. So think of who's writing this? John, right? So now think of John's gospel and think of the times that water, blood, Spirit, that these things are all rather significant, important things. So on the one hand, just as Karen pointed out, at Jesus' baptism, what happened at Jesus' baptism?
This is my beloved son.
Yeah, John says in his John Baptist says in John's gospel, I saw heaven open up and the Spirit come down in the form of a dove and the voice from heaven. Right? And so there you got God himself testifying literally that Jesus is the Son of God. Good? Other points?
Transfiguration.
Yeah. So there you got another time when God himself is testifying. Other things? That this could possibly be talking about?
For the crucifixion, you have the spear wound and the water and blood coming out.
Yeah, so think, we've got this interesting detail in Jesus' crucifixion in which the spear, this is, I think, only in John's gospel where this is recorded, the spear goes into the side of Jesus, and what comes out?
Water and blood.
Water and blood, right? There's a point made that it's both water and blood. Why is that significant that both water and blood came out?
Does that mean that he's already dead?
Yeah, so there's medical reasons. If you're alive and you puncture someone's side, just blood is going to come out. If someone's already dead, then water and blood, there's something with that. So you can read medical things in regards to why it would be significant that water would come out with blood. But it's a medical sign of death. Yeah, but yet, what we've got there is this mention of water and blood. And so, I don't want to labor the point too much. So John 1:29. There you've got the passage that Karen was mentioning. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him and said, look, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Then John gave this testimony. I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remain on him. I would not have known him, except that the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, the man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is he who will baptize with the Holy Spirit. I have seen and I testify. This is the Son of God. John 19, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. The man who saw it has given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth, and he testifies so that you may also believe. So again, this language of testimony at these very points when this happens. So given John's chief concern, and the two sections quoted above from his gospel, what could John mean by saying that the Spirit, water, and blood is God's testimony, that Jesus is his son? Simply that at these points in the life of Jesus, there's this testimony that Jesus is the Messiah, right? And this is eyewitness testimony from John, who is with John the Baptist when John the Baptist said those things. At the end of the day, we cannot say with 100% certainty what in the world John's talking about. This is what he says. There's three that testify, the Spirit, the water, and the blood, and the three are in agreement. In fact, if you look at the textual transmission of the New Testament throughout history, there's a time, about 150, 200 years after the Gospel of John is written, that some scribe had no idea what this meant while he was copying it, and so he added his own sentence. And I think it might be in the King James or something like that, and he stuck in a sentence that has clear Trinitarian language, trying to turn three that testify into a Trinity type thing. But virtually all scholars today, looking at the thousands of manuscripts that we have, it's clear that this was put in at a later time because this was so mysterious, exactly what John's talking about. But we don't need to know for certain what John's talking about to understand his thrust and the testimony that runs throughout John's gospel. It's still all there, right? So we don't need that to be edified by what he has to say. Any questions about that? It's kind of interesting. You have to tie it into his gospel for sure, I think, though. He writes this, 1 John 5:13, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know that you have eternal life. This is the confidence we have in approaching God, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know that we have what we have asked him. So, here's one of those famous parts of the Bible where the writer says, if you pray to God, he'll give you what you ask. Right? So, John tells us, if we ask anything according to God's will, we know that we have what we asked of him. What is God's will? That's the big question, then. How do we know what it is? What are the things that Jesus teaches us are certainly ours because of him? So, can you tell me how to pray according to God's will? How can you ask for things according to God's will and know that you will get them.
Start
okay, start with the Lord's Prayer. There's a hint, such as what? Let's think about this for a minute. What does the Lord's Prayer have in it? So Jesus himself taught us this prayer.
Thy will be done.
Okay, right, so that's that, right? That's actually in the prayer, right? Good. What else? What are the actual things, though, that you're praying for?
Food?
What kind of food, though?
Daily bread.
Translate that. What does that mean, daily bread?
Necessities for life.
Yeah, right, your necessities for life. God promises that he will give you absolutely everything that you need to get you from this point of life to eternity, to walking through those pearly gates. Whatever it is that you need, God promises that you will get. What does he not promise, though?
Mercedes-Benz.
Yeah.
He does not promise everything that you want.
But he does promise that he'll never leave you or forsake you, that he's working all things for your good, that your daily needs, he's going to take care of those things. And so this is part of Christian maturity, in a sense, being able to wake up in the morning and say, you know what, I feel like there's things I need, but I know that at the end of the day, that God, it's not God's will that I have it right now. How can I line up my will with God's? This is part of Christian growth. Good. What other things does he promise in the Lord's Prayer? Our Father who art in heaven.
Forgiveness.
What's that?
Forgiveness.
Forgiveness. Yeah, right. So he promises forgiveness. And this is huge. This is absolutely huge. If you pray to God to forgive your sins, he has to. The Lord's Prayer is permission to twist God's arm. In fact, when Luke teaches the Lord's Prayer, the very next section that comes right after it is what? Knock and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Right? Or knock and the door will be open to you. Seek and you'll find. There's a parable about there's that famous parable about the neighbor that's sleeping and you got something that you need. And so you walk over to your neighbor's house at night and you're banging on the door. And what does the neighbor say? He says, I'm sleeping. Go away. Right? But then Jesus says, because of your persistence, that neighbor's going to give you something. What's Jesus teaching you to do? Yeah, is he teaching us that God is in heaven saying, go away, I'm busy? No, the point is on the persistence, right? That God says you can demand things from him. How is it possible for you to demand things from God? This is hard. How is it possible for you to demand things from God?
We're his children.
Why?
Because of Christ's action taking our place and washing us white in baptism.
Yeah. The payment has been made, and he can't go back on his promises. And so when you say to yourself, there's no way that God can forgive me for this, God says, it's done. The payment's already made. It's not a question of whether or not I will forgive you for these sins. The payment's already been made in the past. And then conversely, you can say to God, you in your prayers, you have to forgive me my sins because Jesus died for me. Good. So we've got forgiveness. We've got food. What else does God promise to us? Lord's Prayer is a good example. Yeah.
Help us avoid temptation.
Yeah, right. To help us avoid temptation or to be with us through temptation, to give us what we need to withstand temptation. When we fall into temptation, the forgiveness is right there to pick us back up. We've got lots of different passages about that. What else? How about the beginning of the Lord's Prayer? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come.
What is that phrase mean, thy kingdom come? We could have stopped on every other word before that as well and expanded them. But thy kingdom come, what does thy kingdom come mean? What's God's kingdom?
Kingdom of believers.
Okay, we've got, I heard lots of things. Did someone say heaven?
Yes.
All right, so God's kingdom is heaven. What else?
Well, we want by his kingdom to come into the hearts of the unbeliever is another idea. Let your kingdom
come.
So they will
get to the kingdom.
So the hearts of those who have faith, Scripture talks about that being part of God's kingdom. Good. So that's two things. Heaven, the heart of a believer. What else? The final one, I think you kind of started with it, Marian. The kingdom of believers. So when you're praying, thy kingdom come, what are you praying?
That everyone become a believer.
Yeah, that God's word goes out and that God's kingdom expands, right? That either on the one hand, you're praying that God will take you home to be heaven, or you're praying that his kingdom here on earth, his kingdom of believers, will expand through the means of grace. Right? We're making it very technical here, but that's what you're praying when you say, your kingdom come, God, that when I share the gospel message, when I go out, when I do these things, you promise me that your word will be effective, that your kingdom will expand. I can't always see it with my eyes. I can't always understand how it's expanding, but you promise me that it is. That's part of being a Christian, is that God says his word will do things, that his kingdom will endure. There will never be a point when God's kingdom is snuffed out here on earth. He makes that promise. Okay, yeah.
How do you reconcile that with, you see people starving?
Yeah. How do you?
I mean, they're supposed to be Christians like we are, but I don't know the answer.
Go ahead, Constantine, start us off.
My answer is this. I will remind you this event where Jesus Christ was going to the bath of Bethesda.
Yeah.
And there was one person who was born blind, so he never saw before. And then Jesus made a miracle, and he began looking. And then I think among these lines was this comment from Jesus Christ who said, because they were asking him, why was this guy born blind? Is it because he's paying for the sins of his parents, which is not fair? Or for his sins? Yeah, but what sins before he was born? And then Jesus Christ said, because the strength of God reveals best in the environment of weakness. That's the answer why there are people starving. Because in this weakness of them, they will see the glory of God, my opinion.
That's a good start, right? So what does God say about our weaknesses? Or what does Paul say about our weaknesses, about his weaknesses? When I'm weak, then he is strong. So we can talk personally, you know, if you're reflecting on yourself and you're asking, why is God allowing certain things happen to me? Why are there certain things that it feels like are necessities, but I'm not getting? Part of the answer to that is, one is, you're never going to know the full answer to that. Right? That's just, if it's not in Scripture, it's not revealed to us. God tells us in Scripture, there are things that are just for me, but what is for this world and for your children, this is revealed in Scripture. So it does not cover absolutely everything. It doesn't. But we can say this, that when I'm weakest, that's when I depend on Christ the most. That God works through these things to draw me closer to his word and to his promises and to depend on him and him alone. We're also told that the pain and suffering of this life, they're a blink of an eye compared to eternity. We're also, it's also very clear that the vast majority of suffering that takes place on this world comes from where?
Sin.
Yeah, right, sinful action. And so it's a call for Christians to do what?
Proclaim the gospel.
Yeah, right, to do something about it. So there's a good joke. I'm going to totally screw it up, right? But it goes something to, you know, I used to ask God, you know, why does he allow so much pain and suffering in this world? But then I've stopped asking him that question. Why I've stopped asking him that question? Because I'm afraid he's going to ask me back. Right? Right? So there's a tremendous amount of pain and suffering that's human inflicted, and Christians are part of that. Christians are called to do something about that as well. But at the end of the day, this is something that we're resting on God's promises. The Christians that you talk to in these situations, many of them after the case, they'll say, the Lord was taking care of my needs, even through these things. I strongly encourage you to ask your South Sudanese brothers and sisters this question. Ask them and see what they have to say about their relationship with God going through very difficult times of hardship, right, on these kind of grand scale questions about large amounts of famine or injustice.
I guess I said I don't have an answer. I do have an answer. That you covered it, is that our time on earth is but a blink.
Yeah.
And God never promised that we wouldn't face trials and tribulations.
Yep.
And you know, at those times our faith is tested. And So, you know, we get stronger in our faith.
Yeah, and I think that's a very good answer if you're, you know, or part of the conversation if you're looking at your own suffering or someone that you know closely, right? Someone that you know closely that's a Christian and you're saying, you know, it's a blink of an eye and I'm with you as you're going through this, right? An opportunity for that. I don't think it's the best answer for if you've got an atheist friend that's asking abstract questions about why is there pain and suffering in this world, right?
Well,
So the
fact is there's more than enough food produced in the world to feed everyone that's here.
Yeah.
All these things are all, there are issues. I mean, why sin comes into this is it's not that the world that God has put together does not produce what's needed for everyone's needs. It's people interfering with that. You can see that in the way food is distributed and all kinds of other things. We have the ability to take care of each other. We have the ability to feed everyone.
Yeah.
But we have sinful people who, you know, use this to accumulate power unto themselves, and they're the ones that are inflicting the suffering in large part along those above those around them.
Yeah, I think we can look at it on a global scale. We can also look at it on a much smaller scale as well. It goes on the macro level, but it also goes at your office at work, right? So there's people that you live with right now, that you work with right now, that have deep things that we would consider needs, right? Essential needs that are not being met, that they would say, how is God not meeting my needs? And the reality is, God's put you right there next to the person to help with these things, right? We're not going to be able to provide what's called like a thorough existential answer to this, you know, where our emotions are going to be okay with it. God's calling us to trust Him on this on some level. Friend.
This verse and yeah. What we're talking about, it's one of the ones that I have a lot of trouble with, and it's along the lines of the same one that, you know, God never gives you more than you're able to handle.
Yeah.
When they're paraphrased and they're taken out of context, they promise more than they deliver, and they lose the essence. Because in that first one, it says, you can ask for anything according to His will.
Yeah.
And we lose that part. I've known a lot of people who reject church, walk away from church, because they hear, you can ask for anything and you will get it.
Yeah.
They completely lose the part about His will in the same way they lose the other part. So those are the kind of things, and you know, there's books written on this, you know, why does God let good things, bad things happen to good people?
Yep.
Someone losing a child, someone having tragedy in their family, you know, whatever it is. We got to be careful how we teach and use those phrases, because they become trite, and they also can become the thing that actually can be turned back on you in conversation and saying, your God promises but doesn't deliver.
Absolutely.
And that's because we're talking about the wrong promise. Mm-hmm.
Yep. I strongly encourage you, this is the topic of conversation, right, with your friends, and you're going to go to Scripture. This is one place to go. The other is that context of the Lord's Prayer I think it's chapter 10 or 11 of Luke, where He teaches the Lord's Prayer there, and then you've got all of those parables and explanations that come after it. Knock and the door will be open, seek and you'll find. You know, these sections that could easily be used, well, I prayed to God, I knocked, and He didn't open the door for me, therefore it's not going to be answered, or therefore God does not exist. The context is the Lord's Prayer, right? The promises, the gospel promises that God gives us, not whatever we can dream up in our minds to ask. Yeah. Yeah, very good. Yeah. It's very important.
Well, in the Lord's Prayer, I mean, as Jesus taught us, there's one petition that relates to our physical needs. Every other petition of that prayer is spiritual.
Yep.
Spiritually based.
Huge point.
If we pray, when we ask the Lord for spiritual maturity, I mean, yes, we have to be in the Word, we have to do what He says, liberal and loose in the means of grace, but He will never deny us that.
Yeah.
And along with spiritual maturity, then I think becomes more and more the desire to help our fellow Christians and also seek unbelievers and bring them into the kingdom.
Yeah. Ditto. Yeah.
And if we were all doing that, and you know, we all fall short. But if we were all doing that on a mighty basis.
Yeah. Think if our lives reflected the priorities put in the Lord's Prayer. Right? Think of the type of impact we might be able to have, right, in our community, in our relationships with people. The reprioritization that creates is just phenomenal. Yep, obviously the key here is whatever you ask according to God's will. So you've got a nice, very straightforward section here that puts that question into context. Well, what if I pray for this? Or what if I pray for that? Is God listening? That's what John's talking about here. If anyone sees his brother commit a sin that does not lead to death, he should pray, and God will give him life. I refer to those whose sin does not lead to death. There's a sin that leads to death. I'm not saying that he should pray about that. All wrongdoing is sin, and there is sin that does not lead to death. All right, so what is John talking about here? There's a sin that leads to death. Again, we wish we could ask him to write a bit more to explain exactly what he means. Based on the rest of Scripture, though, we have several options. So, I've got a full handout in the back. Appendix B, can I lose my faith? Okay? We can't ask John to specifically tell us what he's talking about here, but we can look at the rest of Scripture to come up with our options. So Matthew 10:22, how much we got 10 minutes there? Matthew 10:22 says, the one who stands firm to the end will be saved, yet Romans 11:19 says, you will say then, brothers were broken off so that I could be grafted in. Granted, but they were broken off because of unbelief. And you stand by faith. Do not be arrogant, but tremble, for if God did not spare the natural branches, he will not spare you either. The natural branch is unnatural. What's the context for that? It's not necessary for what we're talking about here, but just if you're wondering about the language, what's he talking about? Yeah, the true Israel versus those of us that are not Jewish that have been grafted in to the vine unnaturally, so to speak. Okay? So he's saying that there are Israelites, Jewish people, that are not part of God's kingdom. Why? Because of unbelief. All right? So although God's word is powerful and active, it is not what we call irresistible. That is, although the Holy Spirit gets all the credit for creating faith, people can resist and reject the gospel message. They can also become Christians and then later reject the gospel. And so the Bible is full of warnings to not reject the gospel. Whether or not you're a Christian hinges entirely upon whether you are going to go to heaven, hinges entirely upon your faith, whether or not you have rejected the gospel message, right, that Jesus has died for your sins. And so when we say faith, we're talking about the object of that faith, that Jesus has died for your sins. How does one reject the gospel then? That's the next question. How is it possible to reject this gospel? The Bible lists several marks of behavior that can lead to rejecting the gospel and so becoming an unbeliever. So the biggest one is, how do you become a Christian? By being connected to God's word, right? Someone shares God's word with you. Someone shares the gospel with you, and the Holy Spirit works through that and creates faith. So, conversely, refusal to stay connected to God's word leads to loss of faith, right? It leads to unbelief. That is the concrete cause and effect of why someone is or is not going to be in heaven, is whether or not they remain connected to God's word, okay? Second, refusal to repent and work towards sanctifying living. So, and this has been one of the themes in 1 John as well. So how does refusal to repent and work towards sanctified living, how does that lead to unbelief? Yeah.
Well, you don't feel you have a need for God.
Yeah, right? You are saying, I do not need Jesus when it comes to these sins. And that will eventually lead to not needing his word, which will eventually lead to unbelief, okay? Despair over sin, that is, believing my sin is too great to be forgiven. So despair in theological circles has a very specific meaning. It wasn't just being sad. Despair means that you are hopeless, that you believe that you are outside of God's potential grace because of what you have done. It is saying God cannot possibly forgive me for this. And that is unbelief. And so what does a person need if they hear that?
God's word.
Yeah, they need God's word. They need to be reconnected where God's word says over and over and over again, God has reconciled the whole world to himself through Christ Jesus, right? That God so loved the world that he gave his one and only son. And then finally, falling into and becoming entrenched in works righteousness. What does that mean?
You gotta earn your way to God.
Yeah. So this is what happens to probably the majority of our friends and family that were in the church for a little while. Maybe they were born, baptized into the church, went through grade school, catechism, and then at some point they just kind of stopped going to church for whatever reason. And if you were to ask them today on their deathbed, this is going to be one of the stories I'm going to tell during our sermon today. If you were to ask them on their deathbed, why do you think you should get into heaven? Their response might be something like,
I lived a good life.
Yeah, right? I've lived a pretty good life, right? And that, of course, is works righteousness. That is unbelief. That is unbelief. At some point, the person has departed from depending on God's promises to get into heaven, and instead now depends on themselves, right? So those are the four categories that we can talk about. And it's not as if they're exclusive categories. They're all related, but the four kind of giant subjects that Scripture talks about in regards to how a person loses their faith. 1 Corinthians 5, 4 through 5, so when you're assembled and I am with you in spirit, and the power of our Lord Jesus is present, hand this man over to Satan for the destruction of the flesh, so that his spirit may be saved on the day of the Lord. This is actually the historical context for our sermon message today. So there was a guy that refused to, thank you, a guy that refused to stop sinning. It was an incestual relationship in Corinth. And Paul said, if he refuses to repent of this, what ought you to do? Yeah. Yeah, and this is love. This is an act of love, right? You are saying this action, because what is refusal to repent? It's something that leads to damnation, right? It leads to unbelief. And so, as a very last resort, you have to say, look, I can't treat you like a Christian if you are going to continue to do this thing that you know is wrong, that you absolutely know is wrong, and that is driving you away from your God and away from the gospel promises. We have to, at some point, draw a line with you, because Scripture tells us this, and I love you, and I want you to be able to address this. This needs to change, or there's eternal consequences because of it. So that's where excommunication fits into the congregation. And then finally, have people in the Bible lost their faith? We've got two fairly clear examples of that. So for example, Saul, he was a prophet for a while. God used us, so this is Saul in the Old Testament, as in David's, so the first king of Israel. And so, for all purposes, it looks like he was a believer when he was a king. He was used by God to do lots of things that he typically uses believers for, things like prophesying, but he definitely died an unbeliever. We know that's the case with Judas Iscariot as well, or at least we could be 99% sure. There is nothing in any of the Gospels that gives us any reason to doubt that Judas was a believer for the majority of Jesus' ministry, but somewhere along the line, he lost his faith. So we got those two examples. Does that make sense? So whatever John's talking about here, we'd love to be able to text him, right, and say, John, just a few more words, please, just gonna clear up what we're talking about. But we know that whatever solution you come up with, it has to fit within these parameters. These are the boundaries and parameters that Scripture gives us when we're talking about why a person is saved or why a person is not saved, okay? And we are literally out of time. We're going to do the last, we're going to read the last words here just so that we can say that we went through every single word of 1 John together. We know that anyone born of God does not continue to sin, right? That's, again, his main point. If you are born of God, then you will seek to change those sinful lifestyles and habits that you have. He's not saying that you'll cease to sin. He says that you're not going to continue in this sinful pattern of lifestyle. The one who is born of God keeps him safe, and the evil one cannot harm him. We know that we are children of God, and that the whole world is under the control of the evil one. We know also that the Son of God has come and has given us understanding so that we may know him who is true. And we are in him who is true, even in his Son, Jesus Christ. He is the true God and eternal life. And then here's the kicker, the very last words of his letter. Dear children, keep yourselves from idols. Why end a letter that way, or a sermon? Wouldn't that be an odd way for me to just end a sermon upstairs? We're talking about lots of other stuff, and then I'd say, oh yeah, keep away from idols. Amen. Why end this way? If you got any questions about this stuff, he has worked it to death in the rest of his letter. It's in our worship folders, but on this last line, yep.
Because basically we're always supposed to keep God as number one. Jesus is number one. His bottom line. For
yeah.
God, everything else is just idle. Mm-hmm.
Luther once said, at least we are always attributed to him, that, you know, breaking commandments 2 through 10 is always breaking commandment 1 in some way, shape, or form. The goal of a Christian is to put God and put his word and to put his name, right? Those first 3 commandments first in our lives. And that's the appeal that he's making at the end here. Anything else to add? Yeah. Yeah, if you would.
So he, through the letter, he's showing who Jesus Christ is.
Yeah.
And that he's brought eternal life and against the false teacher teaching something else. And then this is the true God, Jesus Christ. Keep yourselves from idols, from any other God.
Yeah. So remember the full thrust of his letter here. The full thrust is that you've got a group of Christians, or not Christians, but a group that was in the church and has separated, and they're no longer Christians. And they're no longer Christians because they have screwed up the nature of Christ. They do not believe either that he's fully human or that he's fully God or something in that realm. And this whole point of John's letter is to correct the understanding that Jesus most certainly is the Son of God. That he most certainly was 100% human, yet 100% God for you. And then he teases out the implications of that in our lives. But the first most important thing is in a Christian's life is keeping that truth number one. That Christ is the person that we worship, he is the person that we love, he is the person that we follow, he is the person whose words matter most to us. Everything else has to fall second place to that. He ends, in other words, with an appeal to keep Christ number one. Good. With that, let's bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you for John's letter here. We thank you so much that we have an eyewitness of the resurrection that speaks to us about how to reflect the love of God in this world, who teaches us to stay close to your word, who teaches us to keep Christ paramount, who teaches us that the evidence of keeping Christ paramount is that we are going to then let that love of Christ flow into our lives, that we are going to seek to create a community, that we are going to seek to put away sinful habits and lifestyles that we've had before. Help us in this. We pray that you keep us close to that word so that we have the strength and the power that we need to be the church that you will protect and that you will take until heaven. Thank you for being our God. Thank you for keeping us in the palm of your hand. Amen.